Good evening, class.
Good evening.
My name is Dr. Vicki Knuth, and I will be your moderator for this evening's lecture. And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization. We are dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of His eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was founded as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. We hold classes throughout the United States and various foreign countries. Our Oceanside class was established in 1994. At this time, I'd like to introduce to you the Dean of the School at Oceanside, Dr. Dennis Volpe, and the President, Dr. Carl Immler. Now, in this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The true name of the Holy Spirit manifest in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title, which means that Elohim is a title our Creator has chosen for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that could produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our own English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death, therefore making such names as Jesus and Jehovah impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, and that means having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this form could only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time He walked the earth plane? And a further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of a Holy New Bible. Now also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel up out of Egypt, He called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh later instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle. In this school, we show proof how everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. We have 10 primary constitutional aims or objectives, and they are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Two is to
form
a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Three is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Four is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern, both practical and occult science. Five is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Six is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seven is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eight is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Nine is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10 is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. Tonight we'll be led in prayer by Dr. Bruce Geller. We'll have a scripture read by Dr. Jerry Geller, which will be Romans, the 14th chapter.
Let us all bow our hearts and minds. Heavenly Father Yahweh, we again want to thank you and offer a prayer to you that you open up our hearts and minds, cause us to be still and know that you are Yahweh, and cause us to focus in on the things that are most important. We ask you to help us keep an open mind and keep us correctable at all times, Yahweh, because we know that we are wrong about a whole lot of stuff, and we need correction and guidance and chastisement by you. And we ask that you give us the proper attitude to receive that and to just be content and happy and grateful for those things that you have already showed us. And we ask you to continue to be with us and help us to be good sons and daughters of yours, something that you would be proud of. And in Yahshua the Messiah's most holy name, we ask these things. Let us say hallelujah.
Good evening, class. Tonight I will be reading Romans, the 14th chapter, from the Holy Name Bible. Him that is weak in the faith receive ye, but do not judge his doubtful thoughts. For one believeth that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him that eateth not judge him that eateth, for Yahweh hath received him. Who art thou that judgest another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth. Yea, he shall be holden up, for Yahweh is able to make him stand. One man esteemeth one day above another, another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto Yahweh, and he that regardeth not the day to Yahweh, he doth not regard it. He that eateth, eateth to Yahweh, for he giveth Yahweh thanks, and he that eateth not to Yahweh, he eateth not and giveth Yahweh thanks. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. For whether we live unto Yahweh, and whether we die unto Yahweh. Whether we live therefore or die, we are Yahweh's. For to this end the Messiah both died and rose and revived, that he might be the ruler both of the dead and living. But why dost thou judge thy brother, or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of the Messiah. For as it is written, As I live, saith Yahweh, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to Yahweh. So then every one of us shall give account of himself to Yahweh. Let us not therefore judge one another any more, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. I know, and I am persuaded by Yahshua the Messiah, that there is nothing unclean of itself, but to him that esteemeth anything to be unclean, to him it is unclean. But if thy brother be grieved with thy food, now walkest thou not charitably. Destroy not him with thy food for whom the Messiah died. Let not then your good be evil spoken of. For the kingdom of Yahweh is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. For he that in these things serveth the Messiah is acceptable to Yahweh and approved of men. Let us therefore follow after these things which make for peace, and things wherewith one may edify another. For food destroy not the work of Yahweh. All things indeed are pure, but it is evil for that man who eateth with offense. It is good neither to eat flesh, nor to drink wine, nor anything whereby thy brother stumbleth, or is offended, or is made weak. Hath thou faith? Have it to thyself before Yahweh. Happy is he that condemneth not himself in the thing that he alloweth. And he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Romans, the 14th chapter.
And our first speaker this evening will be Dr. Bruce Geller.
Thank you. Happy to be with you again. The reason I'm up here is a question was asked of me because of a statement that I had made, and I want to clarify it. And I want to try to explain it very, very briefly. The statement that I had made several weeks ago in class was that Yahshua the Messiah, first I was showing how that Yahshua is like the, in reference to a movie or a production, that he's the star of the show, mm-hmm. He's the director of the show,
writer.
He's the producer, that's right. He wrote the script, right? He's done just about, he's wearing, as we might say, a lot of hats. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I say that is that he's the creator of the heaven and earth as well as being the Messiah. So he's performing a lot of functions and therefore wearing a lot of titles or references to what he has done. And one of the statements I made was that Yahshua was not a bit player, which we should know that you know what a bit player is. Do we have to look that up?
No.
I will if I have to, but I agree with Diane. We don't have to look that up. But a bit player is a person who's like, you know, in a movie, somebody that makes a cameo performance, you know, they're just in there for a second. Mm-hmm. Like Alfred Hitchcock, he was a director, and one of the things that he was famous for was he would appear in at least one scene in his movies.
Yep.
Now, Yahshua the Messiah has come in and performed our salvation. Therefore, he's a very central figure in Yahweh's eyesight.
Mm-hmm.
Far from a bit player. But the statement that I made was that the word angel and producer mean the same thing. Now, we're trying to get across principles here, and I'm not making any excuses, and I'm not, if I'm wrong, I want to know I'm wrong, and I want to be straightened out. However, in this instance, you're not going to find the word producer and angel together that I know of in the dictionary, unless, of course, some research has been done, not to my knowledge, that might be able to straighten this out. Now, I'm going to have something read, and I believe, Diane, you have something there on?
Yes. In Merriam-Webster, under the definition of angel,
okay,
it is one who is a backer of a theatrical venture, mm-hmm, who aids or supports with money or influence.
Okay. Now, see, that's the definition for the word angel, correct?
Yeah.
So an angel is a backer, and a producer, by the way, is a backer.
Yeah.
In other words, he's the one generally that offers the financial support to the venture.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I was going to have Vicki, and I'll still thank you, Diane. This goes along right with this as well. Can you read this and tell them where? Tell them where you're reading, Vic, but before you do, we interrupt this program for a very special news bulletin. Go ahead.
I'm just going to read the definition of the word producer.
Okay.
Number 3, a person who supervises or finances the production of a stage or screen production.
He produces or finances. Read that again.
A person who supervises or finances the production of a stage or screen production.
He supervises or finances the production of a
stage or screen production.
Now, what is that the definition for? What
this
word?
This is the definition of producer.
Now, that's the definition of producer, and Diane just got through reading the definition of the word angel.
Is.
Read it again, Diane.
A backer.
Of a theatrical venture.
Who aids or supports with money or influence.
Same thing that you read. So really, angel and producer can be used synonymously. Right? Okay. Now, I want to show you just another point about this. Oh, Vicki, can you read the definition of the word angel? By the way, Jerry, where were you reading? I want to make sure none of these definitions are coming out of any trick dictionaries. Merriam-Webster?
Mm-hmm.
All right, that's a good source, right?
Yes.
And Diane, that's where you were reading from, correct? Tell them where you're reading, Vic. Same thing?
Merriam-Webster.
All right, go ahead.
Angel. Backer of a venture.
There's more in there. A backer of a venture. That's the same thing we just read, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
A player or a political candidate.
A player or a political candidate. Now, I said there was more, but there really wasn't. Now, I want to show you something. Down here in Egypt, the children of Israel were told to take the blood of a lamb and put it on the lintels of their door. That's the frame of the door. And they were told that the death angel would pass over their houses if he saw the blood on the door.
Mm-hmm.
Now that was the death angel, and I want you to understand that that death angel was not Joseph Mengele, who was called, no really,
angel,
Joseph Mengele in Nazi Germany was referred to as the angel of death.
Yes.
Because what he did is he took children and experimented with them, you know, twins, and put needles in.
That's close enough.
All right, I'm not even going to go there.
Thank you.
But what I'm trying to get you to see is that Yahshua the Messiah is the angel of Yahweh. He's also the death angel.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the founder said, and you know, just saying that the founder said without being able to back it up is not good enough for us. Okay, we need proof. He demanded that we ask for proof. So we shouldn't feel ashamed or embarrassed or feel funny to ask somebody. And I'm very glad that this person asked this question, because I kid you not when I tell you that it's been 35 to 40 years since I even ever gave that any thought. That's when I read about an angel and a producer being the same thing. But we love questions, and I'm glad that you're asking them. And if we can't prove what we're saying, we don't have any business saying it, okay? Now, read Exodus, the 3rd chapter. I just want to show you who was in the burning bush and who he's referred to as. Because Yahshua the Messiah, as I said, is the Savior. He's the Creator. He's our Comforter. He is the Spirit of Truth.
In other words, anything on the right from a righteous standpoint, Yahshua is that. He is our righteousness, as the way it is written in the book. Read Exodus, the third chapter, real quickly.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law.
Actually, I'm sorry, Andrea, I needed to be more specific. Get to the bush and who was in it.
Exodus 3 and 2.
Okay.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire.
The angel of Yahweh. Folks, an angel, by the way, the definition for the word angel is messenger.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Yahshua the Messiah is the angel of Yahweh, was the angel that was in that bush. Read, in fact, you'll read about the Lord was in there, and God was in there, and an angel was in there.
Right.
Right?
Right?
That's all Yahshua the Messiah, folks. That's who that was. So I hope that the answer that was given to you was satisfactory. See, we are working with principles, and I'm glad you asked it because I had to dig my own self for the answer. It just didn't say in the dictionary, angel means producer, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But in essence, that's exactly what it is.
Yeah.
If you, you know, dig, and we are a research organization.
Yep.
We've been saying that for years. And I have people that have looked at me just like I stepped off of another planet when I say, can you prove what you just said to me?
Mm-hmm.
And you want to know something? That should be their reasonable service that they do that.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we've been instructed to do. Instead of being so high on our own thoughts,
mm-hmm.
and I'm telling you that it takes power, real, true, genuine power, to get somebody off of their own ideas and onto the genuine truth of the matter,
mm-hmm.
you know? So, as far as having any more on that, I really don't. I hope that I was able to prove to you that and help you to get that answer and keep on asking the questions, whether it's of me. If I don't know it, I'll just refer you to someone else. But we're glad to take them, and there's no question that is off limits. That's you shouldn't ask that. Or now the Dennis, go ahead.
I would like to ask if you could elaborate a little bit on when you said that Yahshua was the angel of death.
Okay. Can we get that in the book in Exodus where it talks about how that the angel will pass through? First of all, an angel is a ministering spirit, and Yahshua the Messiah is the Holy Spirit, right?
Right.
So read that, and I don't know where it is in the book, but it talks about how the angel will pass through this night. And when he sees the blood on the door, he will pass over. In terms of the angel of death, see, Yahshua really has power over life and death. Didn't he tell Moses at the burning bush? In fact, we probably should read it, and it might help in reference to this question. When he told Moses, Moses was given all kinds of excuses, like we would have done at the burning bush, because Yahweh told him, go down, I want you to go down into Egypt and tell the mightiest man in the world at that time, who Yahweh set up as the mightiest man in the world, I want you to go in and tell him that I want you to let my one son go, right? Exodus 11 and 4. Mm-hmm.
And Moses said, thus saith Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
about midnight I will go out into the midst of Egypt.
Right.
And all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sitteth upon his throne, even to the firstborn of the maidservant that is behind the mill.
Hold it right there. Just for one second. There's more in there, though, right?
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead. I want you to get, by the way, somebody get for me Exodus where he said, Israel's my son.
Ninth chapter, first verse.
Well, 9:16 is in very deed for this cause, but I want, where were you reading, Andrea? I interrupted you.
11 and 2.
All right, I'm going to
Excuse me, 11 and 5.
Okay.
Let me start over.
Exodus 4, I believe that it is, and 16 or 4 and 13.
It's Hosea.
No, not Hosea. Hosea says that Israel is...
where you want is actually in 12:23.
Okay, go ahead. 12:23 of Exodus.
Exodus 12:23.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna go up a little bit. Exodus 12:22. And you shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin,
mm-hmm.
and strike it on the lintel and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin.
Okay.
And none of you shall go out at the door of his house until morning. For Yahweh will pass through to smite the Egyptians.
Now there's your answer right there.
Mm-hmm.
See, Yahweh will pass through and smite the Egyptians because they don't have the blood on the door, and Israel does, right?
Yep.
But read that again, Andrea. This is key to the answer to that angel of death. Read.
Exodus 12:23.
Mm-hmm.
For Yahweh will pass through to smite the Egyptians.
Yahweh will pass through. Now, folks... Yahweh and Yahshua are one. They're the same one.
Yes.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yahshua is not Yahweh in his totality. He's Yahweh in part. But he's the son of Yahweh. This form right here, this super incorporeal being, if I can say that, and I can, and I just did, that's Yahshua the Messiah. Right?
Yep.
Again, I'm telling you that he's performing many functions. He's also the death angel. Read it again. For Yahweh shall pass through.
Read this whole thing too.
Read it,
Andrea. For Yahweh will pass through to smite the Egyptians.
Yahweh's going to do that, folks, in the form of Yahshua the Messiah. That's what he did. Now keep going.
And when he seeth the blood upon the lintel,
okay.
and on the two side posts, Yahweh will pass over the door.
That's the death angel, folks. And that's Yahweh that's going to do that. Yahshua the Messiah is the death angel. In other words, he was death unto those that didn't have the blood on the door. Do you follow what I'm saying by that? And they died, folks. They died. If they didn't have the blood on the door, they died. Is there more there? I think that should be pretty clear that Yahweh himself is the death angel as Yahshua the Messiah.
That's correct.
Yep.
That's who the real death angel is. Go ahead, Carl, please.
Go to Revelation 19. Let's go from 7 through 15.
Please read that.
Revelation 19 and 17. Well,
I love the support, and I appreciate it. Go ahead.
And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great elf,
mm-hmm.
that you may eat of the flesh of kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them.
Is that 19?
Mm-hmm. 1917.
Really? I was just going to have, or just about to have Carl get up and help me with this one. See, this is such a wonderful thing. It's not a thing where anybody knows it all. Go ahead, Carl.
Are you reading out of the Holy Name or something?
No, I'm reading out of King James.
So King James, Revelation 19:7.
Oh, 7. I thought you said 17. That's
go ahead. Sorry. Let's try it.
Let us be glad and rejoice.
Let us be glad and rejoice.
And give honor to him.
Give honor to Yahshua the Messiah.
For the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready.
Okay.
And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white.
Mm.
For the fine linen is righteousness of the sons.
Mm.
Keep going. Great.
Go ahead.
And when he saith unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of Elohim. And I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said unto me, see thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant and thy brethren that have thy testimony of Yahshua. Worship Yahweh. For the testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy.
See, we don't worship angels down here, folks. But go ahead.
I know that that sounds very contradictory.
Go down to 9, read through to like 17 or 19. Just read down.
And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse.
There.
And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness.
Who do you suppose that might be, folks, by the way?
Yeah.
Faithful and True. He's the, and he's referred to in the book of Revelations as the true and faithful witness of Yahweh.
Right.
Yahshua the Messiah, that is. The death angel. He's the death angel too.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are people in here that spent more time with the founder than I ever thought of doing. And I'm telling you that hold on. Got to gather my thoughts here. Go ahead, Andrea, please.
Yeah, finish through 16.
Go ahead and finish it up.
And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of Yahweh. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations. And
he smites the nation.
Yeah.
That's what he did down in Egypt. That's what would make him to be the death angel.
Correct.
In other words, those that are not in accord with the, with the gospel. That's right. Those that are not, you know, the death angel is going to take out his vengeance on, if I can put it that way. Read on, Andrea. Is there more there? See how he's a death angel, though. Read that just one more time, Andrea.
And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword.
Out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword.
That with it he should smite the nations.
Now, he's smiting the nations with his words, with his mouth.
Yep.
Okay? And he smote the nation of Egypt down here. In fact, he destroyed it himself. He devastated it with 10 plagues. And everyone that did not have the blood of the Lamb on their door, which is prefiguring Yahshua, having Yahshua, Yahshua's blood or Yahshua in you, that's what this was prefiguring. So read it, keep reading. That's what I wanted, that he smote the nations. That's the point I wanted
to
make.
Finish it to 16, though.
16?
Finish it down to 16.
Go ahead.
And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of the Almighty Elohim.
One more time on that last part.
And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of the Almighty Elohim.
Now, I had a conversation with somebody I'm right on this, trying to thought, but this person was telling me about the loving God. And, you know, it's very difficult to explain to somebody.
Yes.
It's very difficult to explain to somebody that has been, same thing that has been told to us, that Yahweh's wrath is as great as his love.
Yes, it is.
You know, but it is
right.
As great as his love. And he's performing many, many functions. Okay?
Sure.
Is there more there, or is that it?
No. Go to 16.
Just finish it.
And he has, and
where are you at? What verse?
Revelation 19:16.
Okay.
And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Yahweh of Hosts.
Yeah.
King of Kings and Yahweh of Hosts. Now back here, folks, just to let you know, to give you just a little bit of a foundation, Yahshua the Messiah was back here in the land of Egypt, and he was with the children of Israel from the beginning of their migration until the end. He's the one that took them in to inherit the land. Now, the reason I'm mentioning that is because Yahshua back here was not performing our salvation as he was over here on the cross. But nevertheless, that was Yahshua, and it had to be because he's the only one that could take us
from darkness to light,
yes,
or from death to life. He's the only one that can do it. That's why we will never stop giving the glory and the honor to the one and only that is worthy of the glory and honor. And that's Yahshua the Messiah. Now, the reason why I wanted to bring this out is to show you that Yahshua, when he went into Canaan's land with Israel and took them in to their promised land, he defeated many kings back here himself. Yahshua did. Which when he defeated all those and finally took them to their ultimate destination, that Abraham's seed would inherit this land, he was king of kings back there. And he's king of kings now. In fact, he'll never stop being king of kings because he overcame death, hell, and the grave, as we say. And so therefore that makes him to be a king. Now, you could say that everything from a righteous standpoint is all embodied and all in him. And that's why it's so important that we, our souls be in him. You know what amazes me is that most people out here in the world that don't have an understanding and that are searching, and there's many people that are searching out here, many of them, they don't realize how great Yahshua is, and they don't realize that they have a soul that is the most important thing they've been given by Yahweh to mankind. And I tried to explain this to somebody over the weekend, and I tried to explain to them that we all have a soul that's either going to be lost or, as it says, it's going to be saved. Most people don't even give it that much thought that they have a soul.
No.
You know what I'm saying? They don't even think about it.
No.
And yet Yahshua talks about it, that it has more value, you know, than anything else, as the pearl of great price is talked about, you know, and how Yahshua, he's not just making stuff up, as some people have even said, when he makes statements like, I didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners unto repentance. You think he's just talking? He's not. And he is the one, folks, that must enter into our soul. He, that spirit of truth, must enter into us in order to receive him and in order to receive salvation. You wouldn't want to be, folks, back there being one of those people that was in total darkness. Remember, Israel was in Goshen. They had light, right? But the ones that were in total darkness, folks, they didn't have the blood on the door. They didn't do what Israel did, and they suffered for it. They died. And in a type, as it were, that would be like them losing their souls. Now that's, there's nothing. I don't know how to get this across any better than Yahshua's own words. Just get me one scripture and I'm down. I didn't want to stay up here this long. Matthew 11:27. I want where he talks about, I'm going to give you rest. And it's not rest like this kind of rest, although that's a beautiful thing, that, yeah, especially for us older folks. When I take a nap, man, I feel so refreshed. And you know, now that I'm up in age, I got to take one every day. But that's okay, you know? It comes with the territory. But we're talking about a different kind of a Sabbath or rest down here. That this is what Yahshua can do for you. And this is not even so much on the topic, on the question that the woman asked, but I was asked to elaborate, and I give you what I got. Read Matthew 11:20, up before 27, I think it is.
27.
Okay.
All things are delivered unto me of my Father.
Mm-hmm.
And no man knoweth the Son but the Father.
Mm-hmm.
Neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him.
Mm-hmm.
Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden.
Folks, Yahshua, there, it says in the book that there is one thing that Yahshua cannot do. Because a lot of people like to trip you up and say, can God make a rock so big that he himself can't move it?
Yep.
No, I'm telling you, people will ask you questions like this to either try to trip you up or just make the whole thing look as if it's not serious and real, which is very serious and very real what we're talking about down here. Okay, but read. I will give you what? Yeah, in other words, Yahshua can't lie, folks. It's not possible for him to lie. What an Elohim we have here, huh? In other words, you could say some people, they're pretty darn honest for the most part. With Yahshua, there is no most part. That's it. When he says something, that's it. It's truth.
Yep.
And of course, we got to prove it so we know it for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
We have to have Yahshua proven unto us in our heart and mind. Yes, it's great to have him on a chart. These charts are invaluable. But the bottom line, folks, is that's the means to the end. That's not the end.
Mm-hmm.
The end is the spirit of Yahshua in you forever. Mm-hmm. And you don't, here's one for you that'll, you don't die.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you go to the grave, but that soul that's in you is immortal now.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it will be immortal, but you live forever. Oh man, what a gift we've been given down here. But anyway, I don't want to get off the track. I will read.
28. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden.
Who labored and was heavy laden, by the way?
Us.
Who do you think he was talking to back there? There must have been some Jews over there. Some people don't even know that Yahshua himself was a Jew. They really don't. They look, and this idea, by the way, Carl, that was brought up recently, and I heard it when I was a kid, and it's still a stigma. It doesn't bother me, because I don't really consider myself a physical Jew. Hopefully I'm a spiritual Jew, which is one that is not one outwardly, but one that is one inwardly. But it used to be that the Jews were just called Christ killers, and
that was it.
And there's a place for them. You know what I'm saying? In other words, Christianity, not just Christianity, but the world, they, as it were, when the Jews went to the gas chambers in Germany, I'm sure many of them were saying, and I wasn't there, but I wouldn't be surprised if many of them were saying, good for them, they look what they did to our Messiah. What they don't know is that, number one, not only was he a Hebrew, but that his death didn't come as a surprise to him. That he, it says he came unto his own and his own didn't receive him. It could have said in there his own killed him too. In fact, it does say that had they known who he really was, they never would have crucified him.
Right.
But anyways, that's another story. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor. Now the reason I said it was about the Jews is because they had the law and they were laboring with it. And it was a heavy burden unto them because they couldn't keep it.
Yeah.
And he, Yahweh told them back here, knowing that they couldn't keep it, that it would be their righteousness if they did keep it.
Mm-hmm.
And they have been trying to be righteous ever since.
Right.
Ever since. And I heard it mentioned this weekend. People think as long as I live a good life,
mm-hmm.
that's all that God cares about. Well, look, I'm not advocating that you go out and rob a bank and be unkind to people and treat people like, no good. Not saying that. But I am saying this, that as far as Yahweh's criteria for salvation, you have got to have Yahshua's spirit in you.
Right.
That's your ticket.
Right.
That's the thing that Yahweh is looking at.
Right.
When you see him face to face, that's what he's going to be looking at. Is Yahshua your advocate or not? Because I can't go in there alone and look at him. Not
Without Yahshua, I got no chance. Right? That's why it's so important, and we're preaching Yahshua, because Yahshua's spirit is our salvation, folks. It's our ticket. It's everything we want and more. But anyway, he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll do what?
And I will give you rest.
Now, we're all looking for rest. Right? And Yahshua, he is our rest, and he has provided rest, folks, for us. Read on. This is important.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. He wants you to know him. In fact, you can't have salvation without knowing him. They go hand in hand. Knowing him and being and having salvation are synonymous. I think there's a little bit more in there.
For I am meek and lowly in heart.
Thank goodness he's meek
and
lowly.
And you shall find rest unto your souls.
That's what I want. All that, just to get you to see that. I'm going to give you rest unto your body, so that you sleep well at night and you don't need geritol or any of these other. Is that what he said?
No.
Geritol, I don't think that helps you sleep. It gives you
Sominex.
It gives you strong blood. Good blood. Right? Here's the thing. He said, I'll give you rest unto your souls. Now, Yahweh said, all souls are mine. And all the souls that he has created are in his hands. And you'll often hear people say, well, put it all in you got problems? Put it in Yahshua's hands. I've been thinking about a lot of what that means. Because if Yahshua is real to you, and a real entity, a real spirit, which is comprised of attributes, we're not talking about some kind of some smoke in the air. We're talking about a concrete understanding based on the witnesses that Yahweh has provided, right? But he said, I will give you rest. Now, I'm just dumb enough to believe him. You know that? And I know I can't get rest anywhere else. It certainly ain't going to come from anything exterior. So that quickening spirit, the thing that makes us alive, is what we're all about here. And I'm glad to be a part of it. I just hope that I answered that question in a satisfactory way. If it wasn't good enough, I'm not going to be all, man, I didn't answer that person's question. Look, I did the best I could. I gave you what I got. If you need more, we'll give you more. We'll give it to you just like the founder said. He said, make me prove it. Well, we're saying the same thing. Make us prove what we're saying to you. We're not upset. I just hope that it satisfied you and pointed you in the right direction in terms of the producer and the angel. And I'm done, and I thank you for the opportunity.
And our next speaker this evening will be Dr. Dennis Volpe.
There's just a few things that I want to expand upon on what Bruce had worked with. Now, I want to go back over to that point about the angel of death. And I want to work a little bit into the purpose with that as well. Now, I asked Bruce to get up and I asked him the question, expand upon it, because I'm sure that some of you people that might be viewing this video may have had a question about that and weren't sure how to reconcile that statement. Now, let's turn over for a minute to Matthew, the 10th chapter. I'm going to start there, and then we're going to go back over to Exodus. I want you to go to 10:28 there, if you would, please.
Matthew 10:28. Ready?
Yes.
And fear not them which kill the body.
Now, here's Yahshua giving instructions to his apostles, his disciples at this point. And further up in the chapter, he sent them out to preach the gospel, or to preach to them that the kingdom was at hand. And then later, he tells them that they would be not above the master, that if they called the master Beelzebub, they're also going to call the servants Beelzebub. Now, here he tells them not to fear them. He said, fear not them that can kill the body. Read.
But are not able to kill the soul.
Now, they're not able to kill the soul. They can kill your body, but they can't kill your soul. Read.
But rather fear him which is able to destroy.
Now, he said, fear him that is able to destroy, read.
Both soul and body.
Both soul and body. Now, somebody once asked me about this years ago, because their thinking was that that must be the devil. And it's not. The devil does not have the power to destroy your soul. You say, well, what do you mean? I thought the devil can deceive you and then your soul is going to be destroyed. Well, that destruction that we're talking about here is who has the power to cast you to the lake of fire. Now, nowhere do you read anywhere in your scriptures where it says that at the end you're going to stand before Lucifer, and Lucifer will say to the sheep on the left side, go to the lake.
Oh, that's great.
Nowhere can you find me in the scriptures where there's any scripture that says fear the devil. Go on over to Proverbs, the first chapter. Let's find out who you're supposed to fear.
Proverbs 1:7.
All right, that's what I want.
The fear of Yahweh is the beginning of knowledge.
Now it says the fear of Lucifer is the beginning of you not being sent to the lake of fire.
No, that's wrong.
It says the fear of Yahweh is the beginning of knowledge. Now what people don't understand is that Yahweh has the power. I'm talking about, when I say Yahweh, let me be more specific. Yahweh Elohim, and even more specific, Yahshua, has the power to cause you to be cast into the lake of fire. Because we read tonight in one of our scriptures that we're going to stand before the judgment. I think it was our scripture reading tonight.
Yes, it was.
That every man shall stand before the judgment seat of the Messiah. And we know in the 25th chapter that Yahshua put the goats on the left side and the sheep on the right side. The goats were sent to the lake, cast into the lake, and the sheep on the right were brought into the kingdom that was prepared for them from the foundations of the world. Yahshua has the power of life and death. Even the devil is going to fear Yahshua ultimately. And he himself will be subject to the power of Yahshua and cast into the lake of fire. Dr. Kinley said that the lake of fire is a place of diabolical evil inconceivable to a human mind. And he said that if the devil himself knew how terrible the lake of fire is going to be, that he would repent. That's what Dr. Kinley told me in a conversation. Even Lucifer doesn't know how bad it's going to be when he's in the lake. Now the problem is people watch television and they think the devil's sitting up on a throne with a pitchfork and people are down beneath him and he's directing all the suffering.
Right.
And the devil is the king of hell, is what they want you to think, enjoying his reign.
Right. Yeah.
Now, I want you to know that this one will suffer greatly. In fact, he will suffer greater than any other soul that's in the lake. You say, why is that? Because he is, as referred to in the book of Ezekiel, the anointed cherub that covereth. He was set right up. Dr. Kinley said he was set up here. He used the example of the tabernacle with the Ark of the Covenant with Michael and Gabriel being those two archangels witnessing to that which was between them, and that Lucifer was set above them, overshadowing. He used to use the example, put his hands up. and that he was cast down from that position. So here's one that was right up in the most holy place. You understand?
Yeah.
That was set up on high and rebelled against Yahweh Elohim. And therefore, in the end, he will suffer greater than all the others that will be cast into the lake as a result of it. Because the greater your exaltation that Yahweh has put you in, the greater your chastisement and punishment will be as well. You understand? This one is not going to have a great time in the lake of fire. And he knows he has but a short time. You follow? And Yahweh is hidden. Yahweh Elohim is hidden from him what that lake of fire is really going to be like, so that he would then be enabled to do his job to resist him. For had he known, he would fear him and not perpetrate what he's been doing since he was cast out of the angelic. But by keeping him ignorant of just how terrible that punishment is going to be, it fuels him and fuels his ego to think that he is greater than Yahweh Elohim and that he can resist him. You understand? He's going to receive a revelation at the end of this purpose. You go, what are you talking about? The devil's going to get a Oh, yes. He's going to receive a revelation of just how wonderful and high Yahweh Elohim is and how low he is. And a revelation of how terrible Yahweh Elohim's wrath is. He hasn't seen it yet. The only one he went up against was Michael in the war in heaven. He hasn't been up against the Most High yet. You understand? See? And I want you to know, you don't want no parts of that. You don't want to be subject to that wrath that will be poured out. Now that's why Yahshua is admonishing them here who to fear. And that's why in the scriptures it tells you to fear Yahweh. And that's why when they came to Mount Sinai, when Yahweh spoke, the people trembled and were exceedingly fearful. Because the one that they once feared down in Egypt was destroyed by the one they're now standing before. You understand? And the people did shake and quake over here as Yahweh spoke to them and he told them, I am a jealous Elohim. You understand? And Moses warned the people not to provoke him. You understand? They just don't, people don't realize what they're dealing with because they have this concept. And I like what Bruce was saying, people arguing about, you know, he's a loving God. See, that's what you have to tell yourself. So that you don't have to take a good look at that you're not measuring up.
Yeah.
And then you have to do this too. This is another thing that people do. When they think, I'm not such a bad person. I'm living a good life. I pay my taxes. You follow? I've raised my children. I go to work every day. You tell yourself everything you need to think makes you to be worthy. Or to make you to be righteous. And what you use for a comparison to that is you look at people like Hitler. All the terrible things Hitler did. And you look at these murderers out here, these mass murderers. Now people are looking at terrorists, Osama bin Laden, or now the guy from ISIS and the beheadings and all. And they look at this terrible stuff and they say, oh, I'm not like those people. I'm a pretty good person. You got it all wrong, ladies and gentlemen. You're missing the point. It's not them that you should compare yourself to. You have to compare yourself to this one right here. I'm talking about take a good hard look at yourself in comparison to the nature of Yahshua the Messiah. And here's the problem. Unless you know what this nature is and understand it, you really don't know how to compare yourself to it.
Right.
So since people are ignorant of Yahweh Elohim or Yahshua and his soul and his nature, they try to compare to this one.
Yeah.
And think, I'm not so bad.
Right.
But once you stack yourself up and understand something about this kind of righteousness, this kind of wisdom and intelligence, this kind of long-suffering and patience and kindness and mercy and no guile found in his intent, in his heart and his soul, until you take a good hard look at yourself and see the jealousy, the lies that you can perpetuate when it suits you to do it, you follow? The evil that you have wished upon some people and all other kinds of things that go on down in the depths of your soul, you really are not taking the right measure.
Right.
You follow? Well, that's why in our scripture reading tonight, Paul was admonishing them about measuring themselves amongst themselves. You follow?
Right.
Because that's not where the measure comes from. The measure comes from you comparing yourself to Yahshua, and you have to know him in order to be able to do that. And you're going to find out that when you really get a good look at him, and then take a good hard look at yourself, you realize you're going to need mercy. You're going to need forgiveness. You're going to need a lot of cover-up to take place. And that's what Yahshua is going to do. He's going to cover you in his righteousness. Now, I want to go back down here to Exodus because I want to talk about Yahshua is the angel that appeared to Moses in this bush. He is the one that sent Moses down here on a mission. So let's go back over to Exodus 4:22. I want to pick it up where some of the points that Bruce got up here and was trying to work with, and I want to develop some of those things. Now, first of all, this is what Yahweh told Moses down here in Egypt.
Exodus 4:22.
I believe that's what we're after. Let's see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, that's what I want. And wait a minute. Let's start at 19.
Exodus 4:19.
Go ahead.
And Yahweh said unto Moses in Midian, go, return into Egypt, for all the men are dead which sought thy life.
Mm-hmm. Read.
And Moses took his wife and his sons and set them upon an ass.
Read.
And he returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod of Yahweh in his hand.
Now this is right after Yahweh appears to him, Yahweh Elohim, or the angel appears to him in that burning bush. Now right, read. Page 55.
21. And Yahweh said unto Moses, When thou goest to return into Egypt, see that thou do all these wonders before Pharaoh, which I have put in thine hand. But I will harden his heart, that he shall not let the people go.
Now, Yahweh already really let's Joshua was the one who's speaking to Moses. And he tells Moses that when I send you down there, Pharaoh's not going to let you go because I'm going to harden his heart.
Right.
I'm going to cause him to resist.
Yes.
Now in the 9th chapter of Exodus, which we're not going to go over and get right now, he said that for very deep Pharaoh that I may, and at this time plagues upon your heart. That's what he said. Upon well, he has a hard heart, and Yahweh's going to plague that heart. You follow? Pharaoh is lifted up and perceives himself to be a god.
Right.
And that's, according to Egyptian religious belief, Pharaoh was the direct descendant of the sun god, and therefore a god. And he was a god to the people. Now here comes the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the only Elohim. And it's gonna be God against God. You follow? God versus God. Well, Yahweh is gonna destroy Pharaoh, and he sent Israel down here for the intent. He's the one that put them in Egypt. You go, well, what do you mean that he put him in Egypt? Well, he already, back here in the land of Canaan, at the time of Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, mm-hmm. raised up Joseph back there and gave him dreams and the ability to tell these dreams so that when his brothers, who were jealous of him, and that was all set up by your Creator,
would sell him down into the land of Egypt, he would eventually have to interpret the dream of Pharaoh. And the dream was that there was going to be 7 years of plenty in their harvests of their crops, and then 7 years of hard famine. Now that famine was so severe that it drove Israel and all of his sons and their family into the land of Egypt so that Joseph could provide for them there. Mm-hmm. Now here's the beautiful thing. When he sent them down here, he already had their... In other words, Yahweh Elohim, I'm going to use this example, was manifested through Joseph. Mm-hmm. He already had a body down here that would provide for them and take care of them, so that he didn't just send them in there by themselves. In other words, he himself was there first. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. Now they went down there, and by, as you know, time came on and the Pharaoh that was once friendly to them passed away, and then other pharaohs that later despised the Israelites because they were shepherds, mm-hmm. and enslaved them and made them to be a workforce. And they became servants then, or in a sense, because they were enslaved, they were servants of who?
Pharaoh.
Of Pharaoh. Now we find out over in the book of Psalms that Yahweh actually referred to Pharaoh as the dragon, the great red dragon, which is a saying that applies to the devil himself.
Right.
So that was Lucifer down here incarnated in the body of Pharaoh that had control over the Israelites, and the Israelites were doing what? They were serving him.
Right.
So Yahweh put the Israelites in servitude to the devil himself.
Right.
And sending them down from the land of Canaan into the land of Egypt is analogous to them coming out of, as we show you by your pattern, you have three sections here. On the Moses chart, Egypt being the court roundabout, the holy place being, as it were, the wilderness of Sinai, and then Canaan's land being, as it were, the most holy place. So we have them coming out of this most holy place, coming down into the court roundabout by your pattern, if you look at your pattern laid up over this story.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that this is the kingdom that Pharaoh ruled down in the court roundabout to show that he was king of the earth. Because the court roundabout genders to the natural or the physical creation. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, since Pharaoh was given preeminence here from a natural standpoint, and Yahweh's chosen were sent down here according to election or by the purpose to serve Pharaoh, then we know that Yahweh's people, his chosen, were put in service to the devil or to Pharaoh, who was like the devil.
Right.
Right?
Right?
Now, go ahead and read what you're reading, Andrea.
And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith Yahweh.
Go ahead.
Israel is my son.
Now listen. Read that again, Ann. I'm sorry.
And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh.
Now, here's what you're going to do, Moses. This is what you're going to say to Pharaoh. Read.
Thus saith Yahweh.
Thus saith Yahweh.
Israel is my son.
Israel is my son.
Even my
first. Wait a minute. He's my son.
Right.
Pharaoh, in a sense, and I think it even talks about this somewhere in the book. See, it said that when the famine came, the people gave their souls to Pharaoh. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah.
Now, Pharaoh, being likened unto the mystery of iniquity, what we find out then is that Israel's soul was put in captivity or hard bondage to Pharaoh or the devil. And therefore, Lucifer, in his thoughts, thought they were his people, right, that he owned them. Mm-hmm. Now, Yahweh is letting having Moses to tell Pharaoh, they're my son. Read.
Even my firstborn.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, we know then that Israel is Yahweh's son, even his firstborn. Now, we're going to go through
a couple of the areas in the plagues, and I want you to read a couple of places I'm going to direct you to. We're going to start out with let's see. Wait a minute, hang on. We're going to go over to, I want to show you a couple of places here. I want to go to where he first commands Pharaoh to let the people go.
Exodus 5:1, Doug?
Let's see.
8:1.
No, we're going to get there too. Don't worry. I already got that one down.
Yep, it is 5:1.
All right. Well, let's start at 5:1. We'll start there.
Exodus 5:1. And afterward, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, "Thus saith Yahweh, the Elohim of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness."
Now, first thing he tells them is to let the people go that they may hold a feast unto him in the wilderness, all right?
Right.
Now, we know that Pharaoh didn't let him go because Yahweh hardened his heart, right?
Right.
Yep.
Now I want you to go to, let's go to 8:1.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses, "Go unto Pharaoh and say unto him, Thus saith Yahweh, let my people go, that they may serve me."
Now, he already told them to tell Pharaoh that Israel was his son, and the purpose that he wanted Pharaoh to let him go is that they might do what?
Serve him.
Now listen. Yahweh allowed the people to serve Pharaoh for a time.
Yeah.
Now he's telling Pharaoh, let them go, that they may serve me.
That's right.
They belong to me. They're my sons.
That's
right.
Right?
Now, Pharaoh don't want to let him go. You know that.
Right.
So, therefore, what we find out is that Yahweh is going to cause these plagues to come upon him as a result of it. All right, now I want you to go to 8:20.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, "Rise up early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh. Lo, he cometh forth to the water, and say unto him, Thus saith Yahweh, let my people go, that they may serve me."
Now he tells them to let the people go, that they may serve him again.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Now go to 9:1.
Then Yahweh said unto Moses, "Go in unto Pharaoh, and tell him, Thus saith Yahweh, the Elohim of the Hebrews, let my people go, that they may serve me."
Now again he tells Pharaoh to let him go, that they may serve him. See, what we got is the mystery of iniquity doesn't want you serving Yahweh.
Right.
Yeah. He wants you to serve him.
Mm-hmm.
You follow? And when Yahweh is ready to have the people serve him, there's no way in heaven or hell that the devil can stop Yahweh from bringing you out of servitude from the mystery of iniquity. And that's what he's setting up here down in the land of Egypt. Now, I want you to go to 9:13.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, "Rise up early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say unto him, Thus saith Yahweh Elohim of the Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me."
Mm-hmm. Again, he tells them the same message. Let the people go that they may serve me. And this goes on and on throughout these plagues, all right?
Right.
Now I want to get over to the 11th chapter again, where we started reading with Bruce. And I want you to go to 11:4, and we're going to read down from there. Go ahead, Vicki.
And Moses said, "Thus saith Yahweh, about midnight will I go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sitteth upon his throne, even unto the firstborn of the maidservant that is behind the mill, and all the firstborn of beasts."
Mm-hmm. Read.
"And there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt,
mm-hmm,
such as there was none like it, nor..."
Now watch. Yahweh is making it clear here that because Pharaoh won't let his firstborn go, then he's going to destroy all the firstborn in his land.
Mm-hmm.
And he's the one that is the angel of destruction.
Right.
He said, and he was clear about this, he said, thus saith Yahweh, about midnight will I send an angel in the midst of Egypt, right?
No.
He says, will I go?
He said, I will go.
Right.
He didn't say he was going to send Michael down there.
No.
Right.
He didn't say he was sending Gabriel or any other angel.
Right.
He said he was going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as there was none like it, nor shall be like it any more.
Mm-hmm.
But against any of the children of Israel, Israel shall not a dog move his tongue against any man or beast.
Now watch. Here's my point I simply tried to make with that reading. That he said he was the one that was going to go down here, and he was the angel of destruction.
Right.
He was the death angel that was going over the house. Now in the 12th chapter, we're not going to go read that, but here's what happened. The 12th chapter, he now provides a way of salvation for the Israelites.
Right.
Since he decreed that all the firstborn in the land of Egypt would die, and he already made the statement that Israel was his firstborn,
right,
that means that if he was true to his word, then Israel should have all died as well.
Mm-hmm.
But what he did is he provided a way for the firstborn to be saved, his firstborn,
mm-hmm,
his son. And so what he did is, and you all know the story about the lamb that had to be taken out and the blood of the lamb that had to be, so you follow, on the lintels of the door. Mm-hmm. Isn't that right?
Right?
Now what I want you to understand, though, is here we find that Yahweh is both the angel of destruction and the angel of salvation at the same time.
Right.
Salvation to one and destruction to the other.
Right.
The self-same Savior, the self-same compassionate Elohim who had compassion on the Israelites poured out his wrath upon the Egyptians.
Right.
Yep.
Yes.
You understand?
Yep.
To show you that he's both a loving Elohim and compassionate, or having mercy, I want you to get that. I will have mercy. And I believe that's over in the, is that the 14th chapter?
Yeah, with that, the vessels of wrath.
I want you to pick that up.
What chapter?
I think it's in Exodus 14, but I could be wrong, where he explains that he will have mercy on whom he will have mercy.
Okay. Romans
9. No, it's in Exodus. I want it in Exodus. I don't doubt that it's in Romans 9, but I want it in Exodus. Somebody find it for me. If you get it over Romans, it'll cross-reference it.
25:21.
All right, let's get it in 25:21.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, no, that's not it.
Exodus
15 and 13.
All right, Exodus 15 and 13. Thank you. I knew it was over there. I'm just not sure where. All right, now.
Is that good? Exodus 15,
13. Wait a minute.
No.
That's not it either. No.
I believe it's over in Exodus somewhere in the 30...
he tells Moses when
he
goes up to see his glory.
Yes. I think it was in Exodus 33, if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
33:19 for
that.
Yeah. It's 33:19 because it says the same thing in Romans 9.
That's what I want.
34 and 6 and 7 too.
All right, good. We'll get both of those. Now start at 18, Andrea. 33 and 18.
And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. And he said...
Now this is Moses up in the mountain here asking Elohim to show him his glory. Read.
And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of Yahweh before thee, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious.
Now he's saying, I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. Read. In other words, I'll give grace to whoever I want to give grace to. Read.
And will show mercy on whom I will show mercy.
In other words, Yahshua has already chosen, according to election by the purpose that Yahweh himself had formulated, who he will be merciful to and who will receive grace. Mm-hmm. Now down here in the land of Egypt, 9th chapter of Exodus, real quick, 9 and 13 or 16, for very deep for this cause. Go stand before Pharaoh, he said.
9:16.
Read.
And in very deed for this cause have I raised thee up, for to show in thee.
All right, I want to pick up who he's talking to there. So it might be 9:13.
Yes.
13 is read. 9:13.
Go ahead, 13.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, rise up early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say unto him, thus saith Yahweh, the Elohim of the Hebrews.
Go ahead.
Let my people go, that they may serve me.
Now again, he tells them to let them go, that they may serve him. Mm-hmm. Read.
For I will at this time send all my plagues.
Now I'm going to send all my plagues upon, read.
Upon thine heart.
Upon your heart. Now remember, he hardened his heart. Now he's going to send the plagues on his heart. Mm-hmm. See, read.
And upon thy servants.
And upon your servants.
And upon thy people.
And upon your people. Read.
That thou mayest know.
That you might know.
That there is none
there's
like
none
me.
Like. In other words, even the mystery of iniquity is going to have to bow to Yahweh Elohim in the final analysis and recognize there's none like him. Mm-hmm. Read.
None like me in all the earth.
Read.
For now I will stretch out my hand.
I'm going to stretch out my hand, read.
That I may smite thee.
I'm going to smite you. Listen, he said he was going to do it.
Yes.
Right.
He is both the angel of salvation and the angel of destruction.
Right.
Destruction to those that he has purposed by hardening their hearts to be destroyed, and salvation unto those who he is taking pity upon. And right. Being gracious to and having mercy.
Right.
You understand that? Mm-hmm. And you might not think that's fair. Mm-hmm. But guess what? He doesn't care if you think it's fair. Mm-hmm. You know why? Because he's got a purpose in operation. Because you don't comprehend the purpose doesn't make it not fair.
Yeah, that's right.
No more than a child that says, why can't I go out and stay out with my friends till 1 o'clock in the morning? And you go, no, you're going to be in the house by 9:30 or whatever. You know, when I was a kid, we had to be in when the streetlights came on.
That's right.
Right? Yeah. And then when they say, no, you can't, what's the first response? That's not fair.
That's right?
Right?
Yeah.
Now, that you know with kids, they don't understand why you're doing it. They don't recognize why you're setting up those laws. Mm-hmm. And you're doing it for their behalf, on their behalf to keep them safe.
That's right.
You understand? Because you know they don't possess the maturity yet to be able to comprehend the kind of evil that could befall them.
Mm-hmm.
So you're keeping them safe. So the idea is you can stay out while there's light, but when it's dark, you come in. Mm-hmm. See? Now watch. So here, Yahweh is making it clear that he's going to bring us to... bring his wrath upon Pharaoh and his heart and all of his servants. Keep reading.
That I might smite thee and thy people with pestilence.
Read.
And thou shalt be cut off from the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And in very deed.
Now listen, in very deed.
For this cause have I raised thee up.
How did he raise him up?
For to show.
Wait a minute. How did he raise him up?
Joseph's.
Do you remember what Joseph's dream when he came down here and told Pharaoh? Well, when Pharaoh in Egypt had all the grain, all the food, and everybody from all around had to come down there to buy food, what's the law of supply and demand? If there's no supply and a lot of demand, in other words, very little supply and a lot of demand, the price is doing what? It's going up. That means that Yahweh made them wealthy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He rose him up for this reason. In other words, I will cause you to be risen
and I will also bring you low.
Right.
You understand? But there's a purpose. He's not just doing it because Yahweh likes to rise up and then destroy somebody. Yahweh is not, he says, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked.
Yeah, that's right.
He takes pleasure in the righteous, those that are elect, in understanding his kindness and his mercy. But he needs the mystery of iniquity and his host to manifest or magnify, that's the word I'm after, magnify his kindness and his mercy. Thank you. So read that again. For in very deed for this cause have I raised thee up.
For to show in thee my power, that my name may be declared throughout all the earth.
And listen, in other words, it was for his name's sake.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
Right.
Now remember, Yahweh's name means he who causes to exist. But the name that he started out with is not the name that develops as the purpose develops. Why? What do I mean by that? It's not the name that, as the purpose develops, that he will end up with. You go, what are you talking about? Well, Yahweh means he who causes to exist or to be.
Mm-hmm.
But the name that is declared eventually, which is the actual purpose, is Yahshua.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yahshua means that Yahweh willed to be salvation.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what is going to ultimately be declared, that Yahweh is your salvation, that he is the one that has been merciful to you, gracious to you, manifested his kindness and his love.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he's making known to you. You understand?
Yeah.
And therefore, his name has to be declared, that kindness, that love, that mercy, that all of that, by using the mystery of iniquity in his host, who you first served, and then to deliver you from that, to serve him. You understand that? So I'm trying to get you to see that him being the angel of salvation and the angel of destruction is locked up in him for a purpose, not just to show he's we should sit there and dread him because he can destroy us. Well, yes, he can destroy us. But that's not what Yahweh is after with you. With you, he wants you to know his graciousness and his mercy.
Mm-hmm.
Where were you in Exodus 33, Andrea? We didn't finish that. Or 19? No,
it was
17.
It was 19.
19, thank you.
And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wait a minute.
Yeah, keep going.
Yeah.
That's when he puts him in the cleft of the rock. Is that what you're looking
just
for?
Just read 19.
Yes.
And I'll do the rest.
And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and will proclaim the name of Yahweh before thee.
Now listen, he's not just... He said, I'm going to make all my goodness pass before you. Well, what does that mean, his goodness? What does he mean, I'm going to cause my goodness to pass before you? Well, here's what we envision in our mind. This brilliant body that's shining goes by him. We think that's all of his goodness. Here's the reality. Yahweh is setting you up when you come down to this class. He's raising you up on high. I'm talking, he's taken you into the realm of eternity. Those of you that have been so blessed to be able to comprehend the depths of this teaching. And he is passing by or showing you all of his purpose, how it works all the way down through. That's his goodness, ladies and gentlemen. And when you see it, you know what it'll do? It'll light you up.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he's doing. He's proclaiming his goodness. Now, there's parts of it you cannot see yet. So he will cover you because you are not ready yet to see him in his super incorporeal form. Because no man can look upon his face and live. In other words, if Yahweh Elohim appeared to you in his super incorporeal form, you would dissolve. You're being prepared for that revelation at the end. You understand that? And this is preparation. As your eyes adjust to the light of the purpose, And you see how Yahweh is operating. He's bringing, passing by all of his goodness as this purpose comes down through. Your eyes are starting to get a glimmer of the true light of the gospel and of his purpose and plan. And that is adjusting you to be able to then see Yahweh Elohim. Those that look for him a second time, will he appear without spot and blemish as he actually is and truthfully exists? We're going to see him down at the end. And our preparation is necessary for us to be able to handle that. Mm-hmm. Your soul is being prepared. That's what these lectures are doing. Mm-hmm. You understand?
Yep.
Read it again where you were, 19.
And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee.
Read.
And I will proclaim the name of Yahweh.
And what's being proclaimed now? That Yahweh is salvation.
That's right.
That's what we're proclaiming. What does the word proclaim mean? Give me a dictionary definition of proclaim. Now, all of you people, I want you to know if you're having struggling out there in your lives. Here's why we all get stuck at times. We get too caught up in the affairs of this world and stop looking at the things that we're learning down here in class. When we're not conscious of these principles from day in and for every day of our life, and we stop and start looking at the affairs of this life, here's what it's analogous to. When Yahshua came to them and they were in the boat and he was walking on the sea, and Peter said, Yahshua, can I come out? Can I come out to you? He says, come on, Peter. And Peter got out of the boat and was walking on the water. I mean, he was walking on the water. And then all of a sudden, a little wind and tempest started. And as soon as he then took his focus off of Yahshua, and he was thinking about, oh my gosh, the waves are starting to get big. The wind is blowing. What happened to Peter? He started to sink. And what did Yahshua have to do? He reached down with his hand and grabbed him and pulled him back up again. Every time you get your thoughts and your heart and mind off of Yahshua, because this world is a tempest that we live in.
That's right.
Trouble, problems that we all have to deal with day in and day out in our everyday lives. And our heart and mind gets off of the focus of Yahshua. We start to drown in the affairs of this world. We start to sink into it. And Yahshua is so gracious that he reaches down and saves you every time and brings you back up.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you forget that either.
Mm-hmm.
Because every one of us are going through that. See? And when you come down here, I'm telling you, and Yahshua lifts you up in the spirit, you're walking on water, ladies and gentlemen. But what do you mean? The preaching of the gospel is living water. And when you start to see it and you are caught up in it, you're walking on water.
Yeah.
You follow? Go ahead, read what I asked you to get.
I got proclaim in the dictionary.
Please.
To make known by announcing in a public place.
Now, it's to make known something. Now, look, we're trying to make known not just that his name is Y-A-H-S-H-U-A and it's pronounced Yahshua. Some people say that our whole focus is physical letters, Y-A-H-S-H-U-A, and how it's properly pronounced. That's not what we're proclaiming.
Yes.
We are ultimately proclaiming that Yahweh is gracious and that he's merciful and that he is your salvation.
Mm-hmm.
That your soul, and Bruce got up here and talked about how that we could rest in him.
Yes.
How that you can take rest and refuge in Yahshua even when the whole world around you is spinning. Dr. Kinley talks a lot about these kind of ideas in the transcript. If anybody, I recommend you read it, called The Power Within You.
Mm-hmm.
It's learning how to use the gospel and the things you learn down here to cause you to be stable and to rise above the cares and affairs and problems that we all encounter in this life.
Yeah.
It's when we don't use it that we get ourselves in trouble. What else you got to proclaim?
To publish abroad.
Go ahead.
to issue a proclamation outlawing example, a person, never mind.
All right.
That's to it. Give outward indication or show, to declare or to declare to be solemn, official, or formal, to praise or glorify openly or publicly, declare.
And that's what we do down here in this teaching, right to the end. We're going to proclaim the name of Yahshua. We're going to proclaim it, whether you like it or not.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like us using if you have a problem with us using the physical letters YHSHUA and then pronouncing it Yahshua, we'll just proclaim the principles of his name so that you recognize that he is salvation,
mm-hmm.
that he is your Savior, and that it's out of his graciousness and merciful, kind soul that every one of us are allowed to come in here and really understand this teaching. And that's what he did with Moses here. And you know the result of it. When Moses came down out of that mountain, he was lit up.
Mm-hmm.
His skin was shining.
Right.
And those people were so fearful, he had to cover his veil with a face with a veil.
Right.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
See? And you know, I'll say this from knowing the founder. And I mean knowing him. I don't mean just knowing about him. When we would sit with him, and he would take us up into these things that in conversation, it would take us up into the Spirit. There came a time that we couldn't take anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And Doc would have to put a veil on and start just being little old Henry Clifford Kinley, just a sweet old man, to give us time to adjust, you understand? Because
mm-hmm.
he'd take us up, ladies and gentlemen. Those of us that sat around him could tell you, you would get into something and you'd be sitting around him in his apartment, or when we used to go to Springfield with him, and he would take us on up. And we'd sit there for hours with our jaw dropped and
mm-hmm.
absorbing these things that he was showing us. And it got to a point where our brain was full.
Yeah.
We couldn't listen anymore. It was like, we used to call it sponge time years ago.
Yes.
Where it was like when you take a sponge and you put it under the faucet and the water runs and the sponge fills up with all the water and eventually there's no more room for water and the stuff rolls off the sponge. Well, that was sponge time.
Mm-hmm.
And we used to go through sponge time a lot sitting around Dr. Kinley.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we hope that some of you experience when you tune in on these classes. We hope that you experience sponge time. Because nobody listens to one of these lectures and walks away gleaning everything that is said. If you walk out and you got water in your sponge that you've retained, that'll get you through the desert. You follow? You don't need to have to worry about the stuff that fell by the wayside because you're not going to be able to hold it all anyway. All in due time. See, that's what the thing is. These speakers that get up here that are under the influence of Yahshua as they speak, they're artesian wells. They're wells that never, never dry up. There's always, they know how to tap into that water of life, and that water will spring forth as Yahshua commands it, in other words, by his will. We don't do it. I can't get on this floor and all of a sudden, well, geez, you know, I got this, all this stuff I want to throw off. Yahshua's got to move us. And we call it an inspired lecture.
Amen.
Now, every time we come down here, we're inspired to try to get something out.
Yeah.
But when it really starts flowing, ladies and gentlemen, we know who's doing it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not us.
That's right.
But Yahshua's opening the tap.
Mm-hmm.
You follow? And those of you, when you get caught up in it, you're walking on water, ladies and gentlemen. See, fill you right up
mm-hmm.
till you can't hold anymore. See, and you're going to need it too.
Mm-hmm.
We live in a place where water right now is in scarce supply.
Yep.
You follow the rationing out. This is the rest of the country is drowning,
mm-hmm.
but here California, from a standpoint of laying the pattern over the United States, and we've showed these examples in the past how that. You have the east, which is reflective of the court roundabout.
Mm-hmm.
And we can go into each one of these vessels and show you. You got the coal mines down there that they have in Pennsylvania, in those areas there's fires that are never gone out,
right.
that are burning in these coal mines. You got the Great Lakes.
Right.
You follow? See? And, you know, you got the principles also here with oil in the east that they used, that shale oil, and oil that they would make also from coal. Mm-hmm. You go into the holy place, you're in the Midwest, and you have the bread basket there with all of the wheat and everything that they grow for making bread. And you have the down in Texas there where the oil was being pumped out of there as this lampstand principle. And this represents, for example, you get to the Rocky Mountains there, you follow where it's an intercessory point between the Midwest and going into the West.
Right.
Get up into the West here, and now you're in Los Angeles, home of the angels, you follow? And this was all gold, solid gold up here, and they called California the Gold Rush State.
The Golden State.
The Golden State, because of the gold rushes of 49 there, 1849. So what I want you to realize is you can see how this goes by the pattern. Well, here we are, supposedly, in the most holy place, and there's no water.
Yeah.
Plenty of water in the now. Oh, by the way, the drought is officially over in Texas, so I wanted everybody to know that they made it clear that there's no more drought in Texas. And now it's moving up and hitting the central part of the country and up into even Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, and it's moving east and east. They're just getting deluged. Mm-hmm. And we're saying, can't you just take a few trucks or whatever, Morton trucks, just take some trains and start bringing it out here?
Pipeline,
there you go. I want you to know there may be a drought here, but there is no drought spiritually.
Not right.
There's plenty of water if you know where to go, if you know where to find it. And they used to have these people that were supposed to find water. They would use a stick that was like a shape of a Y.
That's right.
And they were called diviners, is that
That's right?
Right. They would go out and they would be led, and all of a sudden something would pull and say, there's water here, is that right?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Now I want you to know that if you know how to lay hold of Yahshua the Messiah, on that, lay your hands on that, you follow that spirit, he can show you where the hidden water is. You follow?
Mm-hmm.
And it takes somebody that he directs too. Hey, the gospel is being preached, and it's being preached in with great power and great conviction, and the spigot is open, and wonderful, wonderful things are being poured out.
Mm-hmm.
And although there's plenty of water, he's not leading everybody to the water.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He's leading only his elect.
That's right.
That's the reality of it. Just like only the elect came up out of the land of Egypt. It was the same thing that saved the Israelites. That is to say, the opening in the Red Sea was the destruction to Pharaoh and his host. The same thing that is your salvation, which is the preaching of Yahshua the Messiah, is the destruction to the mystery of iniquity. Because this is life unto those that are having a revelation and death to those that are having a delusion. Now the devil does not give you a delusion. All delusions are coming from Yahweh. Give me Isaiah, the last chapter in Isaiah, and then I want you to go to Thessalonians. Isaiah 60...
6 and 4.
That's what I want. I want you to start... well, let's start... we got a few minutes. Start at 1 real quick.
66 and 1. Thus saith Yahweh, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool.
Mm-hmm.
Where is the house that you build unto me? And where is the place of my rest?
Mm-hmm.
For all those things hath mine hand made, and all those things which have been, saith Yahweh. I'm sorry, and all those things have been, saith Yahweh. But to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, and tremble at that my word.
Now, listen, you're going to have to tremble at his word. What does that mean? What does it say? What does it have in the margin of the translator for tremble?
66 and 2.
It says,
Is impressed by.
Now listen, when we preach the gospel to you, do you know that we're trying to make an impression in your heart and mind?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that when the high priest went up here on the Day of Atonement and he wore that mitre on his head and there was a plate that said holiness unto Yahweh, that was engraved as a signet? That's what it says in your Bible. Now, a signet was a ring, like for an example, a signet ring is something that the kings would wear, where they would take to put a seal on something. They would press it in wax and then put it down on a piece of paper where they would seal the paper with that symbol of the ring that showed that it was directly from the king.
It was a signature.
Now, what I want you to realize is when the priest tied this plate across his head, and I know some say, well, there was linen on his head. Well, I don't think linen could be that thick of a cloth that when that thing was tied tightly across his head so that it wouldn't fall off, that it couldn't press. It pressed and it made an indentation in the forehead. And what happened is when the priest took this bonnet off and that plate, what was written in his forehead and impressed into his forehead was holiness unto Yahweh.
That's right.
Now, once you hear the true gospel preached, we take the law and the prophet, just like there was a ribbon on both sides of that plate that the priest wore, and he has to tie it in a figure eight. That's a bow.
Mm-hmm.
Right? We take and we show you the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. And when we get that so that it makes an impact in your heart and mind, on your mind, and you see up here it says spirit, what's happening is that holiness unto Yahshua is now written in your heart and mind. When it's written in there, once it's impressed in there, nobody's going to take it out. The problem is not everybody's had that plate on their forehead that's come down here. But those that have been caught up into the most holy place in the spirit can't go in there without that around their forehead.
Mm-hmm.
You understand that?
Mm-hmm.
See? Once you see Yahshua, just like Paul, once he was caught up, there was no getting him off Yahshua from that point forward.
Right.
Paul didn't say, well, you know, I had a good time with Yahshua, but I've moved on.
No.
There wasn't a point where Paul made the statement to them because he was no longer preaching Yahshua, well, I used to think like that. Because once that impression is made, there's no getting it out, ladies and gentlemen.
Mm-hmm.
Keep reading.
3. He that killeth an ox is as if he slew a man. He that sacrificeth a lamb as if he cut off a dog's neck.
Go ahead.
He that offereth an oblation as if he offered swine's blood. He that burneth incense, as if he blessed an idol.
Mm-hmm.
Yea, they have chosen their own ways.
Now they chose their own ways, and their soul delighted in their abominations.
Mm-hmm.
People that are not regarding his words.
Yes.
See, that's what he said in there. See, he that trembleth at my word.
Mm-hmm.
He that is impressed by my word. Mm-hmm. When they're not giving you the words of Yahshua or Yahweh Elohim, then what they're doing is they've chosen their own ways,
yeah.
Their own words. You understand?
Yeah.
Read.
I also will choose their delusions.
Now I will choose their delusions. He didn't say I'm going to send the devil to give them a delusion. He said I will choose their delusions.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And will bring their fears upon them.
And I'll bring their fear. Now that's who you need to fear.
Yeah.
Read.
Because when I call,
well, what, did anybody get a phone call today? Hi, this is Mr. Yahweh Elohim calling.
No.
You follow? Anybody walking down the street, the cloud opened up and said, Carl, this is Yahshua. Well, when did he call? Watch. Hold your finger right there. Get me Hosea 11. In 1, I believe it is. Watch.
Hosea 11 and 1?
Mm-hmm.
When Israel was a child...
Now, when Israel was a child, read.
Then I loved him.
And then I loved him, read.
And called my son out of Egypt.
He called his son out of Egypt. when you were brought down to this teaching, you were chosen in him from the foundations of the world.
Yes.
You were out there serving Pharaoh,
yes,
according to Yahweh's purpose. Mm-hmm. And when the time came, he now said to the mystery of iniquity, let my son go. Let my son Carl, my son Bruce, my son, my daughter, you know, you're, well, those of you that are feminine, you're also a son of Yahweh. My son Diane and the rest of you, see? Let my son go that they may serve me. And when you've been brought up then into the Spirit and allowed to see the purpose and operation, you've been called out of Egypt.
Yeah.
That's when you were called.
Yeah.
When you came down here and heard the gospel preached for the first time. You understand that?
Yep.
That was your calling, ladies and gentlemen.
Right.
See? And though many have been called, yes, few have been chosen.
That's right.
Go back over to Isaiah.
4. I also will choose their delusions and will bring their fears upon them.
Read.
Because when I called, none did answer.
Mm-hmm.
When I spake, they did not hear.
They wouldn't listen, in other words. Not that they were incapable of hearing. They rejected it or turned away from it. Read.
Right. But they did evil before mine eyes and chose that in which I delighted not.
Now that's why he's going to choose their delusion. Now this is what Paul says over there in the book of Thessalonians. Now go get that for me.
Where do you want Thessalonians?
Tell them where it is. Is it 2 Thessalonians?
Yeah.
The 5th chapter, or I'm not sure.
There is no 5th chapter.
All right, then it's not in the 5th chapter.
Start at 10.
Of what?
2 Thessalonians 2 and 10.
2 Thessalonians 2 and 10. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish,
mm-hmm,
because they receive not the love of the truth,
now listen,
they might be saved.
They don't receive a love of the truth. And here's what boggles me. Which of those people that have sat up under this teaching have ever come back here and proven to us that this is not the truth?
None.
How much proof do you need that you can't deny before you finally say it is the truth?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's the reason why people have turned from it. Because they don't love it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
See, I look at the world here. I look at, you know, the rate of divorce and marriage. Mm-hmm. People that stay. I was just reading an article about these people that were married for, 70 years, 75 years, something like that. Some real long time. And there was an article that was talking about why some people remain that long and other people don't. Well, there's some kind of a love that happens between some people that binds them,
mm-hmm,
so that the thought of not being with that person, you understand, is not going to be something that's acceptable to them. That person becomes a part of them.
Mm-hmm.
And they wouldn't separate from that person no more than they would have an arm amputated just because they didn't want it on there anymore. Understand? And the people that said, well, I love you, yes, I'll, you know, till death do us part, yeah, and then all of a sudden down the road there's a little bit of trouble and boom,
yeah,
the love wasn't there from the start.
Right.
Well, people have come down to this gospel and heard this stuff and got all excited, and by just didn't trip your trigger. I'll use that terminology.
Yeah.
You never loved it to start with.
Yes.
There's only one reason why you don't love it, because you haven't been taken on up. Once you've been taken on up, once you caught on to how Yahweh Elohim actually is and truthfully exists and how the purpose works, there's no coming out of that. There's no being without that. There's no separating you from that. And that's why Paul said, who shall separate us,
yes,
from the love that is in Yahshua the Messiah? Because once he saw it, and he didn't see it when he heard it preached at first, you all know that.
Right.
But when Yahshua caught him up And he understood the mercy that was given to him, who was, as he said, an injurious man or a person, a blasphemer, and how kind and merciful Yahshua was to him. There was no separating him from Yahshua's love from that point forward.
That's right.
He saw something that made an impression upon him. I think that's safe to say.
Yeah.
And I think it's also safe to say he was willing to die to defend it and continue to preach it his entire life. And his testimony just before they martyred him was, he said, listen, he said, I fought a good fight, the good fight, and I know that there's a crown of glory that waits for me, that's laid up for me. He was in love with this gospel, ladies and gentlemen. There's no way to separate him from it. And that's not just because he heard correlations either. He saw something in reality that made an indelible impression that could never be taken from him. And that's the way it has to be with each and every one of you that are sitting up under the preaching of this gospel. Otherwise, you have no hope of making, because that mystery of iniquity is, and the verse above that says that with lying wonder. Read the verse above that you just read.
9. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs.
Now Satan has power and signs. Mm-hmm. Read.
And lying wonders.
And lying wonders. Not lying down wonders, but he can lie and get you to be dazzled by it.
Right.
You follow? With all deceivableness of unrighteousness. Is that what it says?
Right.
And them that perish. Now here's the funny thing about the truth. On the surface, it seems like plain Jane. Because it's simple. And after a while, you think, well, there's nothing fancy about that.
Yeah.
I want something fancier. Mm-hmm. But down in the depths of it, ladies and gentlemen, there's jewels down in those parts. There's gold in those parts. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
But you gotta dig down under the surface to find it. Listen, these people, these prospectors, when they went out, they're just trying to hit that vein. You understand? They want to get even these miners of diamonds. They got to go down in the earth. You follow? And these things are covered.
Mm-hmm.
Now I want you to know that the real reality of this teaching has been covered by correlations.
Mm-hmm.
But when Yahshua gets you down in the depths of this thing and shows you this thing, you follow, then in some of these people that were prospectors and miners, that's all they did, ladies and gentlemen, mm-hmm. is they lived out there and they worked in the ground trying to find these nuggets and these jewels. You understand?
Yeah.
See? Because once you've seen it, once you saw one of those diamonds sparkling, sun coming out of it, there's no going back. Mm-hmm. Read. Keep reading.
And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish.
Read.
Because they received not the love of the truth.
Because they didn't receive a love of the truth. Mm-hmm. That's why. Read.
That they might be saved.
That they might be saved. Read.
And for this cause, Yahweh shall send them strong delusion.
And for this cause, Yahweh shall send them strong delusion. Now it's Yahweh that sends the delusion.
Mm-hmm.
It's also Yahshua that gives a revelation.
Yes.
He's both the revelator and the one that gives you a delusion.
Mm-hmm.
See, when we have painted on this chart here, Moses standing here, and he's looking up here at this cloud. You follow? This is him. You follow, as it were, and here's Jethro's flock, witnessing to the burning bush, and remember what was in there, according to Exodus, was an angel. That angel is Yahshua,
yeah.
And he is the revelator and the one that sends delusion. He's both the angel of life and the angel of death.
Mm-hmm.
So, all I'm going to tell you in conclusion, because we're almost out of time, I didn't have anything on my mind particularly when I walked in here tonight, but when Bruce got up here and started hitting into this stuff, Yahshua turned the faucet on.
Mm-hmm.
And I started just recognizing how that's, this is a lecture that we haven't heard a long time about Yahshua being both destroyer and savior. And it's true what he said. I wanted him to elaborate on it because there might be people who never heard that and understand how that works. And I know there's more on it. We got other people sitting here that I know are have got stuff on it, and so this will be continued. You have to tune in on the next class because we got a special guest speaker coming to clean this whole mess up tonight. A couple of them, actually. Yes?
For Jews, their delusions that we've read in
right.
several places.
Okay.
It says in the margin of the translator that Yahweh would select their ideas.
There you go. And as Carl worked with a long time ago, their imaginations. Because some of these ideas are nothing more than an imagination. You follow? And people like it because it's glittering. It's glistening. You follow? And this looks so appealing. Well, that when the mystery of iniquity appeared to Eve here at the tree, he did not. Dr. Kinley made it clear that was no snake wrapped around a tree. And now we painted it that way because. That's the way most people think. But he actually appeared to her as
right.
an angel.
Yes. That's
right. And in the book of Ezekiel, the 28th chapter, it says, "Thou was in Eden, every precious stone was thy covering."
Mm-hmm. Right.
And it started naming them, all these precious stones.
Right.
He just glistened and was dazzling, seemed to be brilliant and full of light. And she looked at that and she thought, "Why, my gosh, it must be true what he's saying. Yahweh wouldn't send somebody this beautiful to us that would say something wrong." And he had her imagine that she wouldn't surely die, that she would become as a god.
Right.
And in her mind, she started thinking what it would be like to be God or to be an Elohim. You follow? The devil's a master at imagination. Do you know that Pharaoh's two court magicians, Janies and Jambres. Look up sometime what a magician does. He creates an illusion or an imagination.
Mm-hmm.
Because illusion and an imagination connect in terms of the principles.
Mm-hmm.
You follow? So we're out of time. We're done. I hope you learned something tonight, those that are watching. And with that, we hope everybody tunes in Saturday night for the continuation of tonight's lecture. So let's all stand and be dismissed with a doxology tonight, and I will ask if Andrea would please dismiss us.
Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of the only wise Yahshua, our Savior, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Let us all that holy through me.
Looking at it?
That's not
why.
Well,
that's how it's written in Jude.
I had it on though. You started messing with it and it went off again.
One.
No. I had the picture back up again.
And
you started messing with it and
went
off again.
In the Holy Name Bible. And some say it the way it's written.
Yeah, I'm
going
to probably have to get another cable.
And they're different.
Oh.
I think as long as you're close, it doesn't matter. It's not like you have a phone.
Here, let's see.
Do you think you could give me a haircut?
It's not the camera.
Yeah.
No.
No, it doesn't even have to be.
My only...